A very good evening, a good morning, and a warm welcome to all present here today. We are really very sorry for the half an hour delay of this program due to certain urgencies and the guests who are arriving here. It is indeed a proud moment for Maulana Azad National Urdu University as well as, and most particularly, the Department of Women Education, who has gone a miles away to organize a program in collaboration with Association of Indian Universities on the most emerging theme, that is called Rethinking Empowerment, Gender and Development. I'll take this opportunity to request the coordinator of this program to accompany our guest on this stage. I request Shahida ma'am to accompany our guest to come on this stage. Please, Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is the chairperson of today's program, Muhammad Aslam Parvez Saab, our chief guest, Professor Shishila Kaushik, please come on this stage, join us. She's not. Thanks a lot. Moving forward, it's now a time to welcome our guest, and the best person to introduce about the guest, who they are, and what eminence they command, and what this program is all about. I request the coordinator of this program, Professor Shahida Murtaza, and presently the Dean of the School of Social Sciences and Arts, to introduce the program. Thank you. Please come, ma'am. I'm sorry, because everything should begin with the taranas, and I asked our media team to go ahead with the tarana of the university.
Zabane Urdu ka aashiqan hai, Zabane Urdu ka aashiqan hai.
Ye jamia hai Zabane Urdu, ye jamia hai Zabane Urdu.
कलाम सारे है दर्ज रूह में कलम से उतरा हुआ बदन है ये इल्म का शहर घर है मेरा मेरा मदरसा मेरा वतन है
तालीम का मौसम है तहजीब की फसलें हैं हम रोशनी करते हैं सूरज की नस्लें हैं
उर्दू जमीन से जो दाना गुजरे थे इस जमीन से वो इल्म के बीज बो गए हैं बड़े हुए जब पौधे पड़के हमारे कद ऊंचे हो गए हैं
हम चांद की पेशानी जब छू के निकलते हैं ना तुम ये पाओ चलते हैं
उर्दू की उड़े खुशबू
ये जामिया है ज़बाने उर्दू ये जामिया है ज़बाने उर्दू ये जामिया है ज़बाने उर्दू
ये जामिया है
different world whenever our tarana is being played. We feel the fragrance of Urdu in every corner. We have the privilege to have amongst us our honorable chief guest, Professor Sheila Kaushik. We have the chairperson of this program, inaugural ceremony, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Muhammad Aslam, Dr. Muhammad Aslam Parvez Sahab. We have our convener representing Association of Indian Universities, Dr. Amrinder Pani Sahab. And we are also having on this stage the coordinator of this program, Professor Shahida Murtaza. I now request the coordinator to welcome our honorable guests, participants who are from across India, and as well as introduce about our guests to the audience present over here. Thank you, Madam. Please join.
Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, everybody. Let me tell you all that today is a very important day for all of us in the department, in the university, that we are going to conduct a national level seminar on a very important topic. For me, especially, I had a very sort of idea, I mean, empowerment, with which I'm going to speak later about it, that why I thought of it as rethinking empowerment and gender and development here, because you may feel it is very unconventional to talk of rethinking this concept. First and foremost, I would like to thank the authorities for giving me permission to organize this seminar, and AIU for that matter for rendering their economic help, financial help which they have rendered to us to conduct this two-day seminar, Dr. Amrinder Pani and his team. I would like to first and foremost introduce our Vice Chancellor. There is nothing I have right now in front of me to introduce, because he has such depth in his personality that it is samandar ke kuze mein band karne ke misdaq hoga. A very good thing has happened to Maulana Azad University since the day he has come and joined as Vice Chancellor here. Quite a person with lot of vision for this university to have it properly developed and on a right path. He's an academician of a very high esteem, a moral of high esteem, and a person who needs a discipline surrounding him always, and he expects the same thing that we reciprocate. I have not much to really, you know, like have to talk about him. The way he has been supporting the academic pursuits in this campus is exemplary. I only hope that we really stand by his expectations in his tenure during his stay over here. I have amidst us Professor Sushila Kaushik, for me Sushila Di. For you all, she's not a new person. She's extremely, extremely concerned about the women's cause. And our association goes back to maybe 30 years that I have known her. We have worked together for quite some time, maybe on a very serious project. And then after that, we've been in touch with some of the other things. She has been an iconic figure for me. And to introduce her, it's a great privilege for me, really. And I'm sure that all of you will endorse that she is a mother figure when it comes to women's studies, discipline, its growth and its reception here in India, and an Indian to the core. And how Indian women's studies should grow, in which direction, she is the one who gives us always. I'm the one who depend always for her advice for any venture whichever I take up. Madam, I would like to really introduce, with your permission, very briefly, we have prepared here. We are privileged to have Professor Kaushik, an internationally renowned scholar of women's studies, who made great contribution to the area as our chief guest. Basically, a political scientist who taught in Delhi University for about 3 decades, Professor Kaushik has contributed to the understanding of women's participation in democratic processes at the panchayati level. Her engagement with grassroots research has resulted in publication of a number of monographs on political science. She headed the Center for Women's Studies at Delhi University and gave new life to the very discipline of women's studies. She has a large number of valuable books to her credit in the field of women's studies. Some of them include Family and Rights of Girls, Empowering Women for Politics, Women's Operation, Patterns and Perspectives, Women in Panchayati Raj, Women's Participation in Politics, Panchayati Raj in Action, Challenges to Women's Role, Knocking the Male Bastion, A Study of Women in 1996 Lok Sabha Elections, Participation of Women in Panchayati Raj in India, A Stock Taking, A Study, Six State, etc. And there is an impressive long list of acclaimed research papers published by her. She was visiting professor on women and development to the universities of British Columbia, Vancouver, University of Calgary, Mount Vincent University, Dalhousie University, and University of Newfoundland, St. John's. And likewise, she visited a number of other countries as well. She has been in a number of national bodies offering guidance on women's issues. To name a few, she was co-chair, UGC Consultative Committee on Capacity Building for Women Managers in Higher Education, Advisory Committees on Women's Studies Center in a quiet few university and colleges, Member Review Committee on Women's Studies, University Grants Commission, New Delhi Member Advisory Committee on Women's Studies, NCRT, New Delhi, Coordinator UGC Conference on Women's Studies, Research Advisor and Member many committees on National Commission for Women, Resource Person and Keynote Person in quite a few workshops and conferences on Women's Studies and Political Science, Resource Person and Women's Studies and Political Science in UGC and CEC program for a number of lectures. Give her a great applause, please. We have another guest, Dr. Amrendra Pani. I have a very brief academic profile, sir, yours. He holds a doctorate degree in education from Punjab University, Chandigarh. He's a specialist in the area of educational measurement and evaluation and research methodology in education. Has vast experience in the field of higher education, educational research, and academic administration. He specializes in research methodology in social sciences and has been a TOT, trainer of the trainers. He has worked in some of the apex level agencies in education like NCRT, Association of Indian Universities, and in some of the premier and reputed academic institutions like Punjab University, Chandigarh, Indira Gandhi National Urban University, New Delhi, Hemvati Nandan Bahugna Garhwal Central University, Uttarakhand in various academic as well as administrative positions. He headed the division of AIU, which convenes the meeting of vice chancellors at those on a national level, and was also worked as Chief Information Officer of AIU under RTI Act 2005. There are 8 edited books and a number of research under publication to his credit. Dr. Pani has the distinct credit of designing and drafting the national guidelines of Anvesan, the National Student Research Convention organized by the Association of Indian University, for identifying and training the young researchers in the country. He has delivered a number of exchange lectures in the area of globalization of higher education, teacher education, research methodology and management of research in higher education institutions, research ecosystem, measurement and evaluation, etc. Dr. Pani has also delivered a number of motivational lectures like developing leadership, effective communication, emotional intelligence, etc. He is at present a deputy director and director in charge of the research division of AIU and editor University News. As head of the research, he is charged with responsibilities of initiating, supervising, conducting research projects, designing student-centric programs, coordination and monitoring, organizing seminars, workshops, and training programs, and bringing out publication on various emerging issues in higher education. This is Dr. Pani. We welcome you, sir. About this seminar, how I got it, very limited time we have, I'll just quickly brief that this very concept of, I thought that we have to problematize the empowerment concept as such. And then there is a rethinking, because after Beijing, all of you know that 1995, what we had decided upon, the choices, the rights and what not for the women. And then we had the CEDA, you know, we have all signed over it. And still we see that the rights of women, and then right to say no, and right to say no against violence, free, a life free of, you know, all type of violence, what we had thought of, what we had decided upon, what we have really signed, the government have really, you know, given a signature to, you know, to this, that we are going to see that our society is free from violence for women. But you see that the rights of women are every day, every moment are being violated. Though we see a lot of women in the society, large number is coming for you maybe, what you see physically, but do you know that how many of us are having that fear of being responsible towards the patriarchal powers, that with the permission, with whatever the thing, educated and the uneducated, we have a lot of other violent, you know, violence being faced every day in our life. And then that there are the right violation everywhere, whether it's a workplace or at home. And how long, 95, if we are signatory to it, it is 2016, the situation is not good. The new type of violence we see in this society, one goes, the other come. Maybe there were no feticides, but see the feticides now. There were no honor killing, maybe now they see that the society is really impregnated with lot of violent acts against the gender, which we have to discuss anyway. But here I thought that really, my friend was telling the other day, you've been very negative about it. I said that empowerment is really, I'm talking, you know, we have to redefine. Have we really reached the empowerment? Have the women reached that state that where we can say that your decision-making power has come to man? It has not yet come. Because we are only, what we see is handful, but still our power is not in our hand. Our decision-making power lies somewhere else, at home, in the family, in the vicinity, whatever is the family vicinity. So that's where I feel we have a lot of sub-themes like we have to discuss over here. The time is really very short. I want to quickly say that a lot of people have come from all over India, from Assam, Jharkhand, Kashmir, Lucknow, Maharashtra. We have people from Odisha. We have from Goa. Then we have from Tamil Nadu, we have from Andhra Pradesh, various parts, and then also from Bengal. So there is quite an agglomeration of people from all over India come together under one roof to discuss the issues on really empowerment, gender and development here. I'm sure it's going to be very fruitful your stay. Thank you so much for responding in large number to our, you know, invitation, and I'm sure that this is going to be very successful outcome, and we are going to bring a good document from this process. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. It was indeed an honor to know our chief guest, convener of this program, our honorable vice chancellor. Indeed, there is a need to think and rethink about the empowerment, because the time has changed. We are not demanding equality. We are demanding we are different. So our differences should be recognized as a separate entity. Anyways, now it's a time to honor our chief guest of honor and chairperson, with a token of love called bouquet. I request Ms. Atha Saima to present a bouquet to our chief guest, Professor Sushila Kaushik, ma'am. Thank you. I request Atha Saima again to present a bouquet to our chairpersons of today's program, Honorable Vice Chancellor. Please. Thank you. I request Yasin Fatima to present a bouquet to the convener of this program, Dr. Amran Rupani. Thank you. So this is indeed a small token of love from us.
This university. Professor Susila Kausik, ma'am, chief guest of today's occasion and this inaugural session. Professor Madam Sahida Murtaza, the coordinator of this program, and the, let me define in my language, the pivotal axis of organizing these activities. Faculty members, teachers, students, delegates of this seminar, and the representative of media, print or electronic, if they are available. I'm really honored to be here just to share a few thoughts about this workshop, background of conceiving for organizing this seminar, and little bit about the background of my organization, its establishment, genesis, objectives. Ladies and gentlemen, I am not an expert in this area, women's studies. I have never worked in this area. Though I have dealt with a number of issues in higher education, and by virtue of my position, being the director of Research and Policy Planning Department of Association of Indian Universities, primarily I am charged with the responsibility of conducting policy researches and providing Government of India, Minister of HRD, some research-based policy input for designing the policies of higher education. And in the entire spectrum of the issues of higher education, I see women development, women empowerment, women empowerment initiatives. That really makes one of the very, very important ingredient of the entire spectrum of higher education. See, I am not equipped with any kind of literature to share with you ki how the study on women issues have been developing and what was its genesis. When did it take to build a momentum to bring awareness about the women empowerment initiatives in our country? I have no idea. But so far as my observation goes, I think maybe past 15-20 years, a large number of issues have been discussed in the arena of higher education, and among them, women empowerment and initiatives, that has taken a first seat rather in the structured academic discourse in the system of higher education. My schooling days, I just want to share you a few situations, how things turn to be, and things ought to be, and things need to be. In my village, simply I was a footballer during my school, college days. Throughout my academic career, I have been a footballer. I just wanted to see one of my friend. I went to his house to call him for a football game. And there is a very typical situation. It was probably 4:30 around in the evening. Ma'am, if I think we are time, we have some time issues. We have to stick to that. Only explaining a few situations, my understanding about the issue, I would like to conclude. But before that, then what happened? I saw the boy was called by his father to the kitchen and he was offered a glass of milk, right? And two of his sisters, they were standing there only in the same premise and they were not. I couldn't understand what might be the issue. Then I asked the boy, who's my friend, and later also the issue was discussed with uncle, who happens to be the father of the boy. See, he wanted, the boy is going to play and build muscle and involve in some physical activities or whatever, so he needed a glass of milk. It's a very small issue. And the girls were not given, they were not offered. It was my boyhood also. Somehow, I do not belong to a family where this kind of discrimination is there. My father is a Sanskrit Vedic scholar. He is an expert of Upanishad, Vedant, Nyaya, and all these aspects. My mother, an equally competent lady. But in my family, I have never seen such kind of discrimination. So that was the first situation. I was baffled. How and why it can happen? First thing. Second thing, when I started reading, studying about various literature, I encountered a book, Enigma. It speaks lots of the things about the World War. And I have some anxiety for studying different kind of detective and historical novels and everything. And many times I found in the literature, whenever there is a war, whenever there is any social problem or issues, women has become the first assault. Women has been discriminated. They have been exploited, tortured, so many things. And I think many of the experts, many of the delegates sitting before me, they may be more conversant, familiar, and even they may be building some opinion about this issue, becoming judgmental,